made a way out of no way. And it didn't come from outside the house. It came from inside the house. He blessed me with a wife that understands and that sacrifices. Then not only did he bless me with a wife, he blessed me internally. He has given me another wind. He has given me another mentality. Now, because my dad's in the house, I gotta wake up earlier. I can't sleep in no more. Now, because my dad's in the house, I get to talk to him a little bit more. Now that my dad's in the house, I get to see what I'm gonna be like when I get old. I told the devil, what you meant for evil, watch God work it out.
Come on, everybody, put your hands together. It's got to get better. All over the world, listen to these words. People come.
People come.
People go.
People go.
Your life has been.
Your life has been.
Out of control.
Out of control.
You're confused.
You're confused.
But don't worry.
Don't worry. Your soul never gets better.
Cause God.
Thought that we were worth saving. What a loving God that you and I have. Compassionate God. And that's why we hear, and that's why we cry out when we think about the love that God has bestowed upon each and every last one of us. And what really breaks you down to your tears when we're honest with ourselves and we recognize that I wasn't worth saving. That I rebelled, I resisted, I ran, I fought. But yet, he would not give up on us. What a mighty God. I want to thank our worship team. Look, they dressed alike today, too, boy. Boy, look at y'all. Y'all look like y'all some newlyweds over there. The Wilcoxes in the house. I love them. Everybody say praise the Lord for the Wilcoxes. Amen. Love your heart. I mean, just a heart to serve, a heart to worship. We thank God for Pastor Wright and Pastor Gerald and all those here who are serving for our media team. Let's say praise the Lord for our hard-working media team. Amen. The media team that has much patience for your pastor. Amen. As we just try to get it right. Amen. But hey, say, we're going to get there. We're going to get there. We're going to get there. But let's get into the Word of God so you can get to your, for those who are going out for breakfast and brunch and those who are going to go back home and cook. We'll be in that great book of John, chapter number 21. And I just thank all of you who are watching on YouTube, on our Facebook, or on our website. Thank you for tuning in with us. And we invite you to come and worship with us when you have the opportunity. So we're in John 21, 1 through 6. And it reads, after these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples at the Sea of Tiberias. And on this wise showed he himself. There were together Simon, Peter, and Thomas, called Didymus, and Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and the others of his disciples. Simon Peter said unto them, I go a-fishing. They say unto him, we also go with thee. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately, and caught nothing all night. But when the morning was now come, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples knew not that it was Jesus. Then Jesus saith unto them, children, have ye any meat? They answered him, no. In verse number 6. And he said unto them, cast the net on the right side of the ship, and ye shall find. They cast therefore, and now they were not able to draw it for the multitude of fish. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. This morning, the Lord just briefly want us to talk to each of us this morning and to let us know that the drought is over. The drought is over. It's Resurrection Sunday. And Resurrection Sunday is the greatest day on the Christian calendar for we as believers. Because on this day, Sunday, it's Sunday that makes Friday good. If Jesus does not get up on Sunday morning, our outstanding debt balance for sin remains past due and continuously accruing compound interest. If Sunday does not happen, we remain in an unrighteous position before God, and death remains on the throne. And for Jesus, it wasn't a good Friday, but a bad Friday. It's Resurrection Sunday that makes the birth of Jesus the greatest birth, because this birth was not only a miracle at conception with the virgin birth, but for those who are still doubting his birth, it's the resurrection after the beating and the burial. When he got up, it confirmed that Jesus was Emmanuel. God is with us. It's Resurrection Sunday that reveals the truths that Jesus had taught were true. The miracles that he had performed were miracles. It's on this Sunday that each of us are reminded that we, as believers of Jesus Christ, that we are not, tell yourself, I'm not ordinary. I'm extraordinary. Because the drought is over for not having the power to think right, to talk right, to live right, and to do right. As we've been given that same spirit that was able to overcome death, it now abides in each of us. That's your reality, and that's my reality of the resurrection power. It lives within us. The drought is over for not having power to overcome our dark side in our lives, because we have a new power that has the power of light to shine. And so this morning, as we reflect on the resurrection of Jesus, we are encouraged with the opportunity, my brothers and sisters, that each of us, as Jesus was resurrected, that our lives or areas in our life can be resurrected as well, where we find ourselves living in a drought. That place of abnormal insufficiency or deficiency, that place in our lives that we find ourselves in lack and not having enough. This morning, I want to encourage you and encourage myself. If I feel like I'm in that place of a drought of peace in my life, it's over this morning. If I'm in that place of not having joy, not having hope, not feeling loved, or not sensing purpose or companionship, I'm here to speak life into your life, that that drought is over, because you have the spirit of the risen King living in you on this day. You see, my brothers and sisters, we've learned the hard way that the gambling boat cannot fill our droughts. The lottery cannot fill our droughts. No matter how much we drink or smoke, it cannot fill our droughts. I'm here to declare, remind others that the resurrection power of Jesus Christ, this is the good news this morning that I want to encourage you, is that the resurrection power of Jesus, tell your neighbor, it continues. It continues each and every day of our lives to help you and I to overcome those dry spots, those dry places in our lives. My brothers and sisters, as Romans 6, 5 through 8 tells us, for you and I have been planted. We've been united. We are growing in the likeness of Jesus Christ, that together in his likeness of his death, that we shall also in his likeness resurrect. Knowing this, that our old man has been crucified, that the sin might be destroyed. And so, my brothers and sisters, this resurrection, many times we look back, that is a past event. This morning, I want to awaken you and to alert you. It's not just a past event. It is a continuous event. Yes, my brothers and sisters, the resurrection, it started with Jesus. But it continues with me, and it continues with you, where Christ is continuously being united and growing and being planted in his likeness in your life and in my life. You see, the more we become like Christ, the less we are like ourselves. Let me repeat that for somebody else. If you don't like yourself, I got a solution for you this morning. Start being like Jesus Christ. The more we are like Christ, the less we are like ourselves, because we're in the newness of Christ. Our text this morning was about revealing to the disciples that the resurrection continues. They had been out all night long fishing, and they had caught nothing. This was abnormal because they were what? Professional fishermen. They knew when to fish. They knew where to fish. And they knew how to fish, unlike your pastor. Pastor Steve Wright can testify to that. But they were unable to catch any fish. This was abnormal for professional fishermen. But hear this story. It takes place in the post-resurrection. The crowds had gone back home. The chief priests had gone back to the temple. The persecutors have gone back to their private life. And the disciples have gone back, not to being boys in the hood, but to be boys fishing on the lake. On the surface, it appears that this is a drought of fish, a drought of food. But as we take a closer look at the text, we discover that not only is it a drought of fish and a drought of food for the family, but more importantly, we discover that there's a deeper need that needs to be met. We learn that despite the fact that the disciples had walked with Jesus, despite the fact they had prayed with Jesus, they had served with Jesus, they had even been rescued by Jesus. But in verse number 4, in chapter number 6, it tells us that the disciples could not identify who Jesus was. They could not recognize Jesus, although they were in his presence. They are in his presence, but they can't recognize him, and they cannot respond to him. That's a message for this morning. We could be in the house of the Lord. We can be among those who are sanctified. We can have the word of God coming down like fresh water. God is trying to pour out. His presence is here, but because we are absent, because our mind is on other things, because our mind is polluted, because our mind is dragged down with the problems of life, we are missing God's presence. God wants me to speak to you online and speak to you here this morning. It's time to tune out all of the noise in the world so you can hear the Lord. Speak to my heart, Lord, this morning. Speak to my soul this morning, Lord. Shake me up this morning, Lord God. I need a word this morning. A word that's going to take me from a drought to an overflow. Anybody here need an overflow this morning? Anybody here tired of being in a drought? Anybody here need a rainfall, the blessings to fall down on your life, on your family life, on your children's life? This morning, God says, tune in. My brothers and my sisters, you see, Jesus, he has changed from before the resurrection to now the after the resurrection. And so if Jesus changes, that means that you and I must change. Because if we try to stay the same and he's moving on, I got some bad news for you. You just might miss your blessings. Could this be why we as believers become disappointed disciples, frustrated followers, and subpar servants, and complaining Christians, all because we keep looking for the old Jesus in the past, the Jesus that we were familiar with, the Jesus that we were comfortable with, the Jesus that we thought we could control? Now, Jesus' message doesn't change, but his methods always are changing to meet new needs and new opportunities to bless and to draw his people unto him. The resurrection represents that God is always doing something new. Stop putting God in the box of tradition. Stop taking them back for what worked for grandma. That was grandma. God got something new for you. Open up your heart. Open up your mind. Open up your life that you can receive this fresh blessing, this new anointing, this new burst of power for your life. Come out of the past so you can reach forward towards what God has for you. We don't serve an old God. We don't serve a dead God. We don't serve a past tense God. We serve a God that looks from the end to the beginning and is always trying to pull us forward. My brothers and sisters, we serve a God that's always upgrading our lives, enhancing our lives, and creating a newness in you and I. The disciples were in Jesus' presence, but they could not identify Jesus' presence. Why is it the scriptures doesn't tell us? So I'm just reading into it. Was it because their mind was not on Jesus? Or was it because their mind was still looking for something in the past? How can we miss being in the presence of Jesus? You see, my brothers and sisters, some of us did not know that our sovereign God could not only look like the sunshine, but he can also look like sadness. Some of us did not know that our sovereign God can not only look like the triumphant God, but he can also look like tragedy, trials, and tribulations, and trouble in our lives. Some of us did not know that our sovereign God can not only look like health, wealth, and prosperity, but our sovereign God can look like poverty, sickness, and the poor. Don't limit how God is going to show up in your life. You see, when the table turns on your life, that's the devil telling you that God is not with you. No, that's the time when God is trying to show you that not only am I your God when everything is going right, but people can't see my power when everything is going right. They will give you credit for your intellect. They will give you credit for how much you exercise, how much you diet, how much what you do. But when you're down on your back and you can't help yourself, when you're back in the corner and you can't turn it around, when you're on your face and you're calling up for the name of Jesus, then everybody would know, everybody would testify, God had to do that. God had to speak into his life. God had to touch his body. God had to touch his finances. That's the God that I know. That's the God that's working in my life right now. He let me see a whole nother dimension of him. So don't fight your trials. Don't fight your tribulations. Open up your life and say, God, be all up in my life and in control. Can I get a hallelujah and a thank you? You see, my brothers and sisters, disciples' faith was fixed on the familiar. They were in the process of missing Jesus' presence. We learned that the disciples' faith in Jesus is like ours sometimes. It's fluctuating all over the place. We see here the disciples were experiencing a drought in their faith. It's in this text where faith for the disciples is not on full, but it's on fumes. Why is it on fumes? It's on fumes, my brothers and sisters. And this is my major point this morning. You see, it's on fumes this morning because the disciples was fumbling around with business as usual. Y'all gotta catch that. They were fumbling around with business as usual. Well, I come to you this morning on Resurrection Sunday, and I come to inform each of us that believe that is no longer business as usual in your life or my life. Here in this text and in this story, somebody said, what do you mean business as usual? Well, see, they were fishermen. And I'm about to get it in my text. I don't want to get ahead of myself. But my first point, everybody say, God initiates. God initiates. God is the one that's initiating this situation with the disciples. But when God initiates, it requires you and I to trust him. We got to trust them not like we usually. God is calling us to trust them at an unusual manner and at an unusual level. The Bible tells us what God starts, he finishes. He that begun a good work, he shall complete it. You see, God's character is at stake in our lives. You see, when God tells you and promises you what he's going to do in your life, if God lets you off the hook, his character is shot. So for God, when he tells you you're going to do something, whether you kick, scream, jump, shout, you might as well surrender, because he's going to carry it out. The God we serve is not distant, but he's all involved in every detail of our lives. God is in the details, initiating change within us to reorganize, rededicate, redirect our lives to go from using business as usual lives to now living unusual lives. You see, the disciples went back to business as usual after the resurrection. They went back to boys on the lake fishing like old times. You see, the problem with this is disciples went back to their career goals, their career achievements that they had abandoned when Jesus has called them to be fishers of men. In Matthew 4:19, Jesus says unto them, follow me and I will make you fishers of what? Men. In John 17:18, Jesus in his high priestly prayer, he says, as thou hast sent me into the world, even so I have sent them into the world. So what's the problem? The problem is after the resurrection, instead of the disciples operating in their calling, they're going back to their career. What we do see the disciples doing is now being fishers instead of being fisher of men. We see the disciples returning to business as usual. Is that what you and I do with the resurrection? That we return to business as usual, where our lives have not changed, where there's no evidence that the Holy Ghost lives within us? You see, the pandemic has caused some of us to go back to our lives before Jesus was in us. Some of us have abandoned our calling, and this morning God is initiating a return back to church. I'm speaking to you online. It's time to come on back into the house of the Lord. The disciples had lost their focus on Christ. They had lost their faithfulness for Christ. They had lost their following Christ. Why? Because they went back to business as usual. The resurrection of Christ comes to change each of us from business as usual to, as Tony Dungy's book says, life uncommon. It's going to be unusual because we're walking by faith and not by sight. It's going to be unusual because we're led by the Spirit and not by the flesh. It's be unusual because we're going to be willing to decrease so that Christ can increase. It's going to be unusual because it's not going to be about us, but it's going to be all about him. It's going to be unusual because we're going to be selfless and not selfish. It's going to be unusual because we're going to be givers and not takers. It's going to be unusual because we're going to be helpers and not haters. It's going to be unusual because we're going to be faithful and not fakers. Can I get an amen? I am going to be an unusual saint that's truly trying to live as God has called me. God initiates because Jesus getting the disciples' attention that the drought in that life, his time is up. Jesus uses this drought to help the disciples to discover the design, the divine. He asked them a question about their career. He says, where is your fruit from all of your labor? He called out to them, friends, have you any fish? God is initiating this opportunity to do what? To intervene into the disciples' drought. So not only does God initiate, tell your neighbor, God intervenes. God intervenes, my brothers and sisters, so that you and I can find our true help. He intervenes to interrupt our failure. You see, Jesus does not expose the disciples' lack to embarrass them. Jesus exposed the disciples' lack to empower them. Jesus empowers them by enlightening them that all of their hard work was not in vain. Did y'all hear that? All of their hard work was not in vain. Their hope was not lost. Jesus asked this question to redirect them to see what they could not see without him. You see, without Jesus, they just saw a drought. Without Jesus, they just saw that last night was a waste of time. Without Jesus, they saw I'm still hungry. I still lack. They saw failure. But with Jesus, the disciples were able to see what they could not see by themselves. You see, by themselves, they saw failure. But with Jesus, they're now able to see a future. By themselves, they were ready to suspend their entire efforts. But with Jesus, they were able to see God's supply. By themselves, they were ready to call it quits and accept defeat. Don't quit. Don't give up. But Jesus asked a question to redirect the disciples from a drought mentality to a divine mentality. Jesus asked a question not to make them look bad, but to make them look on the better side of their situations. He asked a question to expand the disciples' vision to look on the other side of the boat. He says, cast your net on the right side. Not on the right side with the ridiculous Republicans. He says, look to the right side where there is strength. Look to the right side that is able to sustain you and supply for you and to secure you. Look to the right side. As Matthew 22 and 44 says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand. The right side where there is favor. The right side where there is strength. The right side where there is security. The right side, he's leading the disciples back to his calling. He had called them not to keep the gospel to themselves. He had called them to do what? To be an extension of teaching and preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so in Matthew 25 and 34, it says, then shall the king say unto them on his what? Right side. Come ye blessed of my father, inherit the kingdom. He says, get on the right side of being my vessel of drawing other sheep. Don't be on the left side where you let anything and everything come in and come out of your life. Be on the right side where you're standing for some standards. Be on the right side where you can lean back and it's not going to fall to pieces. Be on the right side that you don't have to worry at night who is trying to stab you in the back. Be on the right side, the side of the truth, the side of the light, the side that you can have confidence in. My brothers and sisters, let's all get on the right side. The right side where God so loved the world. The right side where we're able to see how good and how gracious our God is. My brothers and sisters, God wants us on the right side. Now, what's blessing about this is this. That while they were failing all night, there was a future for them. They learned through this situation. Whew. They had been failing. But Jesus asked them a question to show them that your failure is a part of me finishing you. Your failure is a part of me finishing you. You see, they were in that same. Jesus didn't tell them, move your boat. He didn't say go out further, and he didn't say come out closer. He said stay right where you are. What do we do when times get hard and times get tough? Lord, get me up out of this house. Lord, get me up out of this corporation. Lord, get me up out of this church. But God is saying, no, 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 no. Stay right where you are. You are just like these fishermen. Your blessing is right where you are. Do not look no further. The blessing is right here, right now, my brothers and sisters. Because when you're in the hand of the Father, as he preached on Friday night, the Father with his hand, we don't understand how it works. But we know that it does work. They were there all night long. And Jesus tells them to cast it on the right side. What do we learn when they cast it on the right side? That there was a multitude of fish. So the blessing was there all night long. Jesus was preserving their blessings. Preparing their blessing and protecting their blessing. They were just on the wrong side of the boat.
my brothers and sisters, you are closer to your blessings than you can imagine or realize. You are right in your blessings. They did not have to change locations. They just had to change their directions. So don't change, my brother, so quick. They just have to shift their efforts from the left to the right. Tell your neighbor, don't go nowhere. Your blessing is within you. Your healing is within you. Whatever you need, it is right within you, my brothers and sisters. He says, look to the right side with justice and mercy. Look to the right side with peace, joy, and harmony. Look to the right side where you know your help comes from. My last point, not only does God initiate, not only does he intervene and interrupt to let us know we're sitting in our blessings. I want y'all to soak on that right now. You are sitting in your blessing. Your curses is your cure. Your struggle is your success. Your night is going to be your light. Look at whatever you are going through and address it like a friend, because you are about to bless me. Don't be discouraged, my brothers and sisters. Face it, I was just talking to mother the other day, and I said, I'm going through, and I got this challenge over here and this challenge over here, and I was intimidated. I'm confessing before all of y'all. I was intimidated. I said, how in the world am I going to be able to handle this? I got my own business. I'm running a church. I got a wife. I got kids. I'm taking care of my mother over here, and now I have to bring my dad into my house. I said, Lord, now how? I'm in my flesh, amen. I'm like, Lord, how am I going to be able to mentally and physically be able to do it? But God would not let me off the hook. God made a way out of no way. And it didn't come from outside the house. It came from inside the house. He blessed me with a wife that understands and that sacrifices. Then not only did he bless me with a wife, he blessed me internally. He has given me another wind. He has given me another mentality. Now, because my dad's in the house, I gotta wake up earlier. I can't sleep in no more. Now, because my dad's in the house, I get to talk to him a little bit more. Now that my dad's in the house, I get to see what I'm gonna be like when I get old. I told the devil, what you meant for evil, watch God work it out. My brothers and sisters, God initiates, God interrupts, but last and not least, God invites you to breakfast with him. Because when you go to breakfast, tell your neighbor, I'm going to have a breakfast breakthrough. That's right, my brothers and sisters. He invited the disciples with all that fish to come over to the shore. Now, what did they learn when they got to the shore? That what they were looking for, God had already provided. They didn't even have to prepare the fish. The fish was on the grill. It was smelling better than Hearls. It was smelling better than JJ's. It was smelling better than Doc's. It was already smelling good. Jesus just invited them for a breakfast breakthrough. What is that breakfast breakthrough? Peter learned, because Peter had failed Jesus before. Now Peter, you know, Peter was really a gangster. He was a gangster disciple. He was a gangster out there fishing naked. He had to put some clothes on to get back to Jesus on the shore. But Peter, he gets there. He's with a state of guilt. He's feeling down. And what does Jesus do? He doesn't curse him. He doesn't remind him of his failure. He blesses him. Come dine with me. Come dine with me, because I'm going to show you that you're not going to live in your drought no more, Peter. I know you failed me, but I'm going to bless you, Peter. I'm going to bless you, but then I'm going to break you from giving up on me again. You see, when God invites us to breakfast, he's going to bless us, but then he's going to break us for giving up on us. Because he's going to bless you to break you that he can build you. Because what did he tell Peter? He said, Peter, I want you to go feed my sheep. Do you love me, Peter? Lord, you know I love you. feed my sheep. He asked him three times to ingrain them into Peter. I'm not going to let you off the hook. I know you're a failure. I know you're rough around the edges. But guess what? You the perfect tool for me to send out into the world and to work with the crooked people, to work with the drunk, to work with the drug addict, to work with all the corrupt and nasty people. God takes all of us and uses them for his glory. Tell your neighbor, God initiates, God intervenes, and then God invites. My brothers and sisters, I'll tell you this little story and then we'll be all done. For those of you who are going through a drought, I'm going to give you this lesson and I want you to send a tithe to my dad for this one. But when you're going through a drought, a lot of times we try to hide. A lot of times we try to go in our corner and keep it in the closet. We don't want to share with nobody else. We're too prideful. Well, my dad, he don't care. It's one, it's two, it's three, it's four. Now I sleep hard. So the house can be burned down and your pastor is going to be ashes. And so my dad is on a medication and one of the side effects, it makes you thirsty. And so in the middle of the night, what comes out of my dad's mouth is, "Baron!" And so initially we can't hear, so my daughter hears. So my daughter starts texting my mom, "Grandpa downstairs screaming, Byron." And then it just keeps getting louder. "Byron! Byron! Byron!" He don't care. Why doesn't he care? Because he knows I'm in a house of love. And I know if I scream loud enough, sooner or later, no matter what they're doing, no matter how far away they are, they gonna get up. Even they gotta get up in they night clothes, bad breath and everything else, and come running down there to take care of me. Well, what am I trying to say to somebody here this morning and on Facebook that's going through a drought? God is telling me to tell you, you got to stop whispering to them. You got to learn how to trust me and cry out from the bottom of your heart. Know that I hear and I answer prayers. Know that I'm the God that sits high, but I'm looking low. No, I'm the God that got ears that are so sensitive. I hear when you moan and you groan. God wants you to cry out, "Help me, Lord. Intercede in my situations." God wants you to cry out for your help. Don't go quiet. Don't go on mute. Don't be ashamed. Cry out and let the whole world know I got a God that I'm not too ashamed to cry out to. But you know what really blesses my soul? After he cries and I get down and I give him the water. You would have think that I gave my dad some filet mignon. Because after he drinks, he goes, "Thank you, Byron. Thank you, Byron. Thank you, 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 thank you." What's my message this morning? After you cried out to God and God has quenched your thirst, God has blessed you with an overflow, don't forget to tell God, "Thank you, Lord. Thank you for healing my mind. Thank you for healing my soul. Thank you for putting food on my table. Thank you for blessing my mama and my daddy. Thank you, God, for just being faithful to my life." Give him thanks. Life Church on Facebook, come off of mute and let's just thank God for being God in our lives. Let's not let the rocks cry out. And that's my last point, my brothers and sisters. Cry out to God. Thank God. Because when we cry out loud enough, then we're going to take Matthew 28 and go tell somebody. If God did it for me, God will do it for you. Go tell somebody that God's grace is available for you. Go tell somebody that this power I have that you can have. Tell somebody God loves you. He loved you so much that he gave his only begotten son. Go tell somebody Jesus wants you to come back. Come back to the shore. Come back and learn everything you've been stressing yourself for. God has already prepared for you. Go tell somebody. My brothers and sisters, God loves you. The drought is over because of resurrection power. Tell your neighbor, it continues. It continues. It continues. Because God is initiating, God is interceding, and God is inviting us to the breakfast table of a breakthrough. May God bless you and may keep you in Jesus' name. The drought, tell yourself, the drought is over. The drought is over. The drought is over. No more drought in my mind, in my life. It is over.